And so, I will go to the gallows unrepentant, knowing that I have done what was right. Was done only for the love of my country, my ideals, and the principles I have lived by all my life. And so... and so I go to my death with head held high, proud but not dishonored.
By heavens, you're a brave man, Sir Giles.
There are others like me, as you will find out. Not quite so brave, possibly, but brave enough.
Giles, I implore thee, give them the names of the others and save your life.
Never. Courage, Ariadne, courage. You would not care to live with a man who betrayed his cause. We will meet again sometime. Somewhere.
Sir Giles Gervais, the executioner awaits.
I'm ready. The blindfold will not be necessary. Lead on, my lord. I go to immortality. Where goest thou?
Arkadam, that went well tonight, didn't it?
Yes, very good. I felt them warming up in the second act. I got them halfway through the torture scene. It was my screams that got them. Hello, the curtain's going up. Right, all old hands in line, heads down for a quick bow.
Oh, I thought you were marvellous tonight, Tone.
Don't call me Tone, there's a good girl. Your Ariadne was coming along better tonight, Heather. Just watch it a bit in the farewell. You were overdoing the sobs tonight, taking the attention right off me, you were.
Oh, I'm sorry, Tone. I just thought it called for it.
Well, it didn't. Hello, it's going up again. Principles forward. Hold hands, heads down. Flash the teeth up to the balcony. Ah, my public, they love me out there tonight. Listen to them beating the daylights out of their hands there.
Are you going to give them a speech tonight, Tone?
I might, as it's Saturday. Hello, it's going up again. Right, me on me own this time. Hop it, you lot. Thank you. Bless you all. Right, all on for another one. Come on, hurry up. One more curtain is the record for this place. Donald Wolford only got 3 for the Demon Barber. Right, heads down, all step forward. Thank you, you're too kind. Thank you. On behalf of the entire company, myself, I should like to thank you for this wonderful reception you've given us tonight. It's always a great thrill to play to such highly receptive, critical, and highly intelligent audiences as one always finds here in Middlesbrough.
Huddersfield.
Yes, of course, Huddersfield. And we all look forward to the day when we will be able to return to the stage of this magnificent theatre of yours, the Alhambra.
The Empire,
yes. Thank you very much. Look after yourselves. Have a good weekend. Be nice to each other and drive carefully. Farewell, Bolton, Huddersfield.
Put your foot in it again, Tone. Fancy forgetting which town you're in.
Look, Heather, stop calling me Tone. When I'm doing the straight drama, I'm Anthony. It's bad enough being called Tony. Let's have a little respect for the principal. It isn't right for subsidiary members of the cast to address the principal with diminutives. Wilfred Hyde White doesn't allow his bit players to go around calling him Chalky.
Well, I've seen some people get carried away with their own importance. Now, let me tell you, I've been in the business for a few years
yes,
now.
Yes, and some of us know how many.
Don't get personal. I've seen some big heads in my day, but if you carry on like this, we'll have to get a bigger rope for the hanging scene.
I don't find that particularly amusing. You're getting vicious, my dear.
Oh, good night.
Right, see you on Monday morning, Scarborough, early.
I'll be there.
Oh, by the way, what are we doing?
The Tale of Two Cities.
Oh, yes, I've got another death scene in that, haven't I? I have me bonce whipped off again. And don't forget, when I'm doing the far, far better thing I do now than I have ever done, I want it to be. Don't cough. You completely killed it at Sunderland the other week.
Oh, all right. Here, coming round to the Chancellor's, have a quick one.
No, not tonight. I'm getting off home to London for the weekend. Have a rest and watch some television, you know. I'll see you Monday morning.
You reading, Sid?
Well, that's what I usually have a book up in front of my face for.
Oh. Sid?
What?
What's it like reading?
It's all right. Something to do. Nothing to go mad about.
Well, if you don't like it, why don't you read Tubbs' postcards?
Because I've read them, and they're worse than the book.
Read them for me again, then.
Oh, blimey. All right. Which one do you want to hear?
The one from Grimsby with a picture of the lady fish gutters on the front.
Right. Grimsby. Going like a bomb. Packed every night. The legitimate theatre is the life. No more variety for me. Send a pair of clean socks and see if my new Astrakhan coat is ready.
He's doing well, though, isn't he?
Seems to be. I would never have believed it. Him, a straight actor. A 3 weeks correspondence course in the method and he's got him away.
Read the one from Barnsley.
Barnsley. Bigger triumph than Grimsby. Standing room only. Riots at the stage door. A star is born. Fated everywhere. Champagne parties till dawn. P.S. Where are those clean socks?
Well, I'll bet all this will make a difference to him. He'll be mixing with a higher class of people now. He'll probably move into Chelsea with the clever dicks. He's got his reputation to think of now.
I hope he does move. As long as he dibs up my 10%, he can go where he likes.
Aha! What is this I see is before me? Two scurvy knaves, perchance, both with their dirty great plates on the table. Come on, get them off.
Tub, I didn't know you were coming home.
Obviously. The place is like a pigsty. I always thought you never cleaned it up when I was away. Who knows, I might have walked in here with Dame Sybil Thorndyke on my arm. Fine impression this would have given her.
Go sit down and have a bottle of beer.
Oh, thank you.
Well, how'd you go last week?
What can I say? Broke the box office records, 4 curtain calls last night, crowds outside the stage
door. Yeah, never mind about all that old cod's wallop. How much loot did you come away with?
£15, less me health stamp.
£15, that's 10% of 15, that's 1K5. 30 bob. 30 bob? Is that all I get for the week? 30 bob?
I did the work. You've just been lying here scratching yourself.
I got you to book in. I want more than 30 bob.
What you must realize, Sidney, is that straight actors do not earn the same money as comedians. It's a completely different line of business.
Then go back to the comedy. You were earning hundreds at that. Get the red nose and the big boots on and get out and earn some loot.
Never. I finish with professional buffoonery. I'm an actor now. People in this country respect you when you don't get laughs. They tip their hats when they pass you in the street. Morning, sir, they say. Sir. Sir. Ah, what music. I never got called sir when I was a comic, not once. It was always, aye, aye, big feet, hello, mate.
Well, all comics get that. It's because they like you. They're being familiar, friendly. They like to think they're mates of yours. Don't you want people to be matey with you?
No, I don't. I want respect. I want to be aloof. I want to be considered above it all, unattainable. Like all the knights of the theatre. People don't get matey with them. They don't call Sir Michael Redgrave big feet when he walks down the street. People respect him because they got dignity, you see. I want the old touch of the forelock when I'm being driven down the high street in the back of me landau. I might give him a slight inclination of the head and a few limp hand waves.
Yeah, well, don't be surprised if you get a few limp cabbages, too.
Welcome home, Tub.
Thank you, William.
Nice to see you home again.
Thank you. It's nice to be home.
Have you brought the plug for the television set home with you?
Of course.
Well, can we have it then to put it on?
Certainly. Here it is.
Why do you always have to take our plug with you? Why can't you leave it on the set?
I should think so. I'm not having you wearing out my tube. I know you. It'll be on all day. From the racing at Cheltenham right through to the national anthem. When I go on tour, the plug goes with me.
Oh, which program shall we have it on?
I don't care.
Well, what do you fancy, with or without advertisements?
Yes, well, let's have it, let's have it without advertisements tonight. Australian buffoon. I'm feeling rather cultural. What's on?
BBC, a Western.
Oh, dear. What's an ITA, then?
ITA? A Western.
I'll put the BBC on. It might be a cultural western.
Right.
I'm a-coming to get you, Wyoming.
Well, which one do you prefer?
Oh, leave it where it is. He rides a better class of horse on this one. Turn the sound up a bit.
Well, you killed him like you said you would, Michael.
Yep, but I don't feel good about it.
But he was a killer.
He was a man. Don't ever forget that. The people who are going to come after us are going to build this country of ours into a place where decent folk can live in freedom. They got to see that boys like him get a better chance in life.
He's soft-hearted, you know. He's a fool to himself. They'll get him one day. He never likes killing anybody. 150 he's done in since this program started, and he still hasn't got used to it.
You got to remember, there's good in all of us. You just got to dig down inside a man until you find it.
He's right, you know. He's dead right. He's got his fair share of brains underneath that big hat. There's good in all of us. We could do with more deep thinking like that.
I suppose you're right, Marshal.
Yep. Well, send him up to Boot Hill and let's get on back to Dodge.
Well, that's it then, is it? I want to see you play that part. Very good. Oh, here he comes. Marshall played by June. Now, that was a girl. Don't mean they're whipping the credits up quickly. Come on, I've missed them all. Makeup bike. Well, who cares who made them up? Honestly, why don't they slow down the credits? See the list of characters? You look along the docks to see who it was and he's gone.
Hey, look, the advertisements are starting.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, hello. There's that bird sitting in the bath covered with soap. She's a lovely girl. She'll be coming in the dance hall in a minute, 2 hours later. There you are. Look, there she is. Oh, done up to the nines. There's the bloke who dances with her. He's a drip, that one. I don't know what she sees in him. I wouldn't waste a bar of soap on him. Hello. Hello, here's a cartoon one. Oh, it's him. Oh, he asked me on the floor there. Oh, dear, oh, dear. Oh, dear. The way he walks up the side of those buildings. They all have more of these, you know. He's a guy. Hello, here's another one. Fancy him doing adverts. I wouldn't go on an advert. Takes away all your dignity.
Why don't you stop rabbiting on about dignity?
Well, it does. How can one retain one's dignity blabbing on about frozen peas?
Will you keep quiet? I never heard one word that man said.
I'm just surprised at actors of his standing doing things like that. Hello, another cartoon. Hey, this is a new one. I haven't seen it on before. What's it advertising?
Cornflakes.
Oh, yeah, he's holding them up so we can see what the cutout is. Ooh, a cardboard fort and a red Indian. That's worth having. You'll be telling us how good they are now and how we're taking chances with our elf, not eating them. Here he goes.
Here you are, then. This is stuff for you lot. Harper's Cornflakes. Get a plateful of this down you and you won't know what hit you. You'll be jumping about all over the place.
Why don't you shut up? I'm trying to listen to this bloke talking.
It's not me, it's him on the screen. I haven't said a word.
Him? Get away, it was you.
It wasn't, I tell you, it was him, listen.
Don't forget then, every breakfast time, eyes down for a plateful of Harper's.
Stone me, I'm being impersonated.
Harper's, stone me, you'll love 'em.
Liberty, it's a dead ringer for me. He's impersonating me.
Why don't you buy a packet and make your breakfast time a real Harper's half hour?
Harper's half hour. Did you hear that? How dare they do this to me? I've never been so impersonated in all my life. Switch it off.
Well, what a sauce.
Now, come on, be honest. You've been making adverts on the side, haven't you? All this stuff about dignity. You have been making yourself a few bob on the cornflakes without telling us, trying to do me out of my 10%.
I tell you, I don't know anything about it. I wouldn't lend my name to a thing like that.
Your name wasn't mentioned. It was just your voice. Hoping I wouldn't know it was you.
It wasn't me.
How much money did you get for it?
I didn't get any money for it.
What do they pay in cornflakes?
For the last time, it's nothing to do with me. It's somebody impersonating me.
Ah, well, it doesn't make any difference.
It makes a lot of difference. I wouldn't mind so much if they were good cornflakes. I've tried those things. They're terrible. No noise at all when you pour the milk on. No, it's complete silence. Not a peep out of them. Just lie there and soak it up. I take a very serious view of this. Nobody asked my permission. Could well make me the laughing stock of the entire theatre. It'll take all my dignity away from me.
Of course it won't. Nobody will realise it's you.
It's not me.
Well, I won't realise it sounds like you.
Well, we'll see. I'm at Scarborough next week. We'll soon see what the public reaction is. Marguerite, 'tis you. They let you come to the prison to see me.
Oh, my darling, what have they done to you?
Courage, Marguerite, courage. You've been good to me. What can I do? What can I give you to show my appreciation for your devotion?
Give them a packet of Harper's.
Yes, yes, yes. Oh, Marguerite, I don't know where to find the strength to face the executioner.
Have a spoonful of Harper's.
Do you mind, please? Give the artist a fair hearing, please. 'Tis a far, far better thing I do now than I have ever done.
Well, it's certainly better than that advertisement.
Oh, this is ridiculous. Curtain, curtain, bring down the curtain. I knew it. I knew this would happen. Ruined the whole performance they did.
And what about me? You ought to know better, a man in your position stopping to make tatty adverts. Haven't you got any artistic integrity?
Have a care, madam. You're talking to the star. Dame Edith Evans has been after your part, you know.
Oh, well, she can have it. I've never been so humiliated in all my life. Harper's cornflakes.
Well, it was nothing to do with me.
Well, here comes the manager. I bet he'll have something to say to you.
All right, Hancock, here's your money. I'm paying you off.
I beg your pardon?
You heard. I run a straight theatre here. My regular patrons have been complaining.
But I didn't do the advert.
It was your voice. That's good enough for me.
Ruined. A brilliant career struck down by a packet of cornflakes. Well, we'll see about this. I shall sue for damages.
Court will rise. Case number 12 on the list. Hancock versus Harper's Cornflakes. Mr. Justice Spooner presiding.
Continue.
The plaintiff is suing the defendants for damages suffered to his professional reputation and loss of subsequent earnings due to an alleged impersonation of his voice in a television advertisement.
I see. Well, who's going to start?
May we have the case for the plaintiff, please?
My lord! Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, my client is a world-famous celebrity.
I've never heard of him.
Well, he's quite well-known. His case, in a nutshell, is that the defendants used an impression of his voice without his knowledge or permission, and it has made him the laughing stock of his profession and has resulted in loss of engagements and a considerable amount of money. He is claiming copyright on his absence.
I beg your pardon?
His absence. His absence choice, his voice.
Would you please confine yourself to expressions in common usage?
Well, it's in usage down our way, mate. I don't know where you live.
My place of residence is no concern of this court. Besides, I'm certainly not telling a man of your record where I live. Continue.
Yes, sir. I call William Billabong Kerr.
Do you think that's wise?
Call William Billabong Kerr.
Is your name William Billabong Kerr?
Yes, known professionally as Billo the Performing Man. I do a dog act, and he just sits there and barks, and I do all the tricks.
We are not interested in your profession. Get on with it.
Mr. Kerr, will you tell the court, in my own words, what happened to 23 railway cuttings on the 25th last?
You and me got drunk.
Before that?
We opened the bottle.
No, before that.
Oh, we went and bought it.
I'm not talking about the booze up, son. what happened while we were watching television.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, Mr. Hancock came home after a hard day at the theater and told us how well he'd done and what a big name he was now. Whereupon, we switched on the telly and we were confronted by a Western. So we turned over and we were confronted by another Western, which was just as good, stroke bad. After which, we were entertained by commercials, one of which was a little bloke who burst his way through a packet of cornflakes and told us how good they were in Mr. Hancock's voice.
Are you sure it was Mr. Hancock's voice?
Oh, yes, I thought it was him at first.
How did you know that it was not Mr. Hancock?
Well, it couldn't have been. He's too big to come out of a cornflake packet.
I mean the voice. How did you know it was not Mr. Hancock's voice?
Because I was sitting next to him and I watched him and his lips didn't move once while the little bloke was talking.
It could have been a record of Mr. Hancock's voice?
I refuse to answer that question on the grounds that I might incriminate myself.
Step down, you ratbag. I will now proceed to prove that the voice was not Mr. Hancock's own voice, but a deliberate impersonation. Call Anthony Hancock.
Call Anthony Hancock.
Are you Anthony Hancock?
I am.
Did you at any time ever lend your voice to a cornflake advert?
Never.
Did you ever agree to let anyone else impersonate you for the purposes of making a cornflake advert?
Again, I must reply, never.
And would you say that the voice on that advert was similar to yours?
Similar? A dead ringer, your worship. And as a dead ringer, I was amazed. Flabbergasted is more the word. 100% 22 carat flabbergasted. Well, if anyone hadn't known different, they would have thought it was me.
And thousands of people have subsequently thought that it was, in fact, you that done it.
I should say so. It's been a source of great embarrassment to me ever since.
Would you tell the court, please, just how this vulgar impersonation has affected your theatrical career?
Do I have to?
I think the court ought to know.
Very well. It's a tale of the utmost woe. Humiliation has been heaped on me. I've been ridiculed from all parts of the house. Prices of the seats has been no barrier. I have been chiyiked from the balcony. From the dress circle and from the stalls. And last week, the final indignity. Chiyiked from the raspberry mousse and drink on a stick girls. To continue. At Newcastle on Tyne, in my rendition of Hamlet, halfway through the ghost scene, when I was reeling back saying, "What is this I see before me?" There came from the back of the stalls a distinct cry, "A bowl of Harper's, mate!" In Nanook of the North. Even the stagehand started taking the mickey. I opened the door of my igloo in the frozen north and walked straight out into a cornflake storm.
Tell me, Mr. Hancock, what has been the effect on your future engagements?
All cancelled. 15 managements have cancelled my booking at a personal loss to me of earnings amounting to no less than 73 quid.
But you're asking for £100,000.
Well, they can afford it. I read the papers. Stone me, you can get 50,000 for being hit on the head and not being able to smell your dinner.
Your worship, what my client means is that his star was in the ascendancy. Who knows what gigantic fees I could have been screwing him for now. That will be all, Mr. Hancock. You may stand down.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to place on record my appreciation for you up on the bench. Yes, you, the one with the wig on. You've been most helpful. I know you're going to do your best for me, and if I do all right, you're on a pint of cider in the Law Court Arms afterwards. I can't say fairer than that.
Would you step down, please, and keep quiet?
Oh, yes, of course.
I will now call the villain of the piece, the man who was responsible for the impersonation of Mr. Hancock's voice. Call Arthur Plowright.
Call Arthur Plowright.
You are Arthur Plowright of no fixed abode?
I am.
And what is your speciality?
I'm an impressionist.
Were you the man who was employed to provide the voice on the Harper's Cornflake advert?
That's right.
Did you or did you not make a conscious attempt to impersonate my client?
No.
Will you demonstrate to the court, please, the voice you used for the advert in question? Read this phrase in that same voice.
Good evening, and welcome to Hancock's Half Hour.
It's me. You all heard him. That's me. Come on, where's the money?
Be quiet. Sit down. I wish to hear a comparison of the two vices. The plaintiff will step up next to Mr. Plowright. You will both hold a conversation with each other. You, Mr. Plowright, using the voice in the advert. Go.
How dare you use my voice?
I am not using your voice.
Yes, you are. You're doing it now.
I am not. It's a voice I invented.
This is ridiculous. It's like looking in a mirror. That is my voice.
It's a coincidence. I've never even heard of you.
Stone me. He's cheeky as well.
Are you asking for a punch up the bracket?
You heard him. That's mine. Punch up the bracket. I always use that. It's up at the Lord Chamberlain's with me name on it. Patented, that is. All right, say this. Hancock's half hour.
Hancock's half hour.
150,000. I put me prize up. It's an open and shut case. I demand justice.
Well, you won, Tub.
And quite right, too. What a liberty.
Pity about the damages. That's a big drop, you know, from 150,000 to 73 quid.
Still, I proved my point. That's the main thing. And they've put in an injunction against him. He can't use my voice on any more cornflake adverts. I've got my dignity back, if nothing else.
And that's all you have got.
Well, my acting career is finished, I know, but I've still got my radio show.
You have not.
Pardon?
A bloke from the BBC was in court. He thought the other bloke sounded more like you than you do. So he's fired you and booked him instead.
They can't do that. How can you have Hancock's half hour with no Hancock?
Nobody's going to know the difference.
Well, I will. I'll be out of work.
No, you won't, boy. I got a booking for you.
Doing what?
The voice for some more cornflake adverts. Five a week in it for you.
But this Arthur Plowright will be making much more than that doing my job. I'm starting at the bottom again.
Well, it's your own fault. You shouldn't have sued him in the first place.
But you're my agent.
Oh, no, I'm not. I'm his agent now. Tedder, all the best, mate.
Well, of all the dirty tricks.
What are you going to do now, Tub?
Brush up on my impressions for these adverts. If he can get on by being sued, so can I. Here you are, Edward Everett Horton. Oh, oh dear, oh. Cornflakes, no, that's no good at all. Charles Lawton. Mr. Christian, bring me some Harpers or I'll have you strung up from the highest yardarm of the British Navy. No, Robert Newton. Ah, Jim Lad. Here's your cornflakes, lad. Ha ha, ha ha.